Let us pray. Almighty God and our Heavenly Father, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we come with joy and gladness before you today. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of coming to study your word, because it is the word that strengthens us, that gives us faith and increases our faith, that makes us to know what will become of our lives if we continue to obey you. It is this word that gives us trust and confidence in you. It is through this word we're able to see the meaning of life. We thank you, Father, because as we come today, your Spirit is mightily present with us to lead us into the word, and so that we can learn much out of your word. Thank you, Lord, because you have granted us the privilege of looking at the history of the children of Israel. We recollect your word that say that these things are written for our learning, upon whom the ends of the world are come. And truly, as we look at the milestones in the lives of the children of Israel, we see many similarities and parallels between them and our lives. And Lord, we learn quite a lot on how to be victorious, on how to walk with you, how to fellowship with you. And Father, we pray that all these things that we learn will benefit our lives in Jesus' name. Oh Lord, we come to a milestone today, to an important subject today. And we pray, oh Lord, that as we learn, as we read, as we study together, that great will be the benefit upon every life that listens in Jesus' name. Oh Lord, we pray that as a result of this study, that your praise will fill our mouth, your testimony will fill our mouth, and that, Lord, victory will be ours in Jesus' name. Lord, go with us into the study. As we went through with the children of Israel all through their lives, going before them, coming behind them, guiding them, we are praying that in the same way, that as we look at this chapter today, you'll go before us. You will teach us your word. You will enlighten us, and you will so inspire the word within us, Lord, that all our defeat will be turned into a conquering, into joy, and into victory in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, that as a result of these studies, the trials and testings and temptations of life will give way to triumph in our lives. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name, we pray. Today we come in our series of studies in the book of Exodus to an important chapter. And it's chapter 15 of Exodus. Well, this chapter is very important because there are some verses in this chapter that will really encourage the believer. If we were to just pick out some verses and study those verses alone, there is much study, much depth in some of the verses. In fact, I'm sure you know this, perhaps, that the song we normally sing, that is the chorus, it's in this chapter that you'll find that chorus. Look at verse 11 before I get into the real study proper. It says, "Who is like unto thee, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like thee, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders?" Maybe you just sang that chorus and you never knew where it came from. Here is where it comes from. Again, I want to bring you back to the beginning of the study in the book of Exodus. You remember that at that time we said that the book shows the need of redemption. It shows the might of the Redeemer. It also shows the worship and the fellowship of the redeemed. It shows the duty of those who are redeemed. And where do we find the whole of that summary? It is in this chapter. It just shows you the importance of the chapter. Look at verse 13. "Now in thy mercy hast led forth the people which thou hast redeemed." And then it says, "Thou hast guided them into thy in thy strength unto thy holy habitation." Well, as we also think about the power of God, and about the fact that when you go to the book of Revelation, it says eventually the kingdoms of the world are become the kingdom of our God, of our Christ, and that the Lord will reign forever and ever. Do you know that this song here and this chapter here gives us the note of victory? And it tells us that the Lord will definitely reign. Look at verse 18. The Lord shall reign forever and ever. Well, as we have been looking at the various chapters in the book of Exodus, you've seen a chapter, for example, that talks about redemption. And you've seen a chapter now that talks about the whole scope, the whole extent, the depth and the height of redemption. Not only that, you have seen the incomparable God. The God that is so much above the gods, above the idols, the one that is glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders. As we talk about the signs and wonders and the fact that in Luke chapter 1 verse 37, when it says with God, all things are possible. Here is what we find in this chapter telling us that our God does wonders. But now, let us really come to the chapter itself. I now start from verse 1. Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider as he thrown into the sea. Let's stop right there. In that verse 1, it says, then sang Moses. It says, this song is sung unto the Lord. And then it says, I will sing. Which tells you at the introductory verse that the chapter is talking about the song of Israel. But what kind of song? It was Israel's song of deliverance. Israel's song of deliverance. That makes this chapter the first song recorded in scripture. The first mention of anything in scripture reveals much concerning that subject. There is much for the Christian church to learn about singing, about songs, in this first recorded song. Well, you need to understand, because if you will try to follow me, there is a lot of change in singing today. You see, many songs have been sung. And you see, there are people in the world who do not even know God, they sing. In fact, singing has become part of the lifestyle of every tribe in the world. Part of the life of the majority of people in any community. Children like singing, and adults like singing. And there is singing that you hear outside the church. There is singing that you hear inside the church. But this is the beginning of the history of all forms of singing. Unfortunately, men have not fully studied this first song in the scripture. Because you see, this first song tells us many things about the kind of songs we should be singing. And about the purpose of singing. And about the source of singing. And about the reason for singing. We've seen the reason here in the very title. As we say, it is Israel's song of deliverance. The children of Israel had just been delivered out of the hand of the enemy. And because of that, song just rose up spontaneously out of their hearts. That's the best kind of singing. The best kind of singing is the one that rises up spontaneously out of the heart. We're not told that these people went to any music school, but the joy, the deliverance, the victory, the triumph that they have got as they saw all those Egyptians floating upon the Red Sea, and they looked at the place where they had come out. It is like they had been delivered out of the watery grave, and coming out of that grave in the middle of the river, something just rose up from them and they began to sing unto the Lord. And so then you see how important it is. Look at now chapter 14. Verse 30, chapter 14, verse 30. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore. And Israel saw the great work which the Lord did upon the Egyptians, And the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. Now the very next verse, and they sang. You see then that singing came out of what the Lord had done for them. This is the oldest song recorded in scripture. It is the oldest poem in the world, and in sublimity of conception and grandeur of expression, it is unsurpassed by anything that has been written since. In this song, we see no polytheism, that is, no idolatry. We see no plurality of gods. And we see no foolish superstition, no suggestion of immorality or glorification of force or the flesh. Instead, what do we see in the song as we study, as we read? You will discover, we see the firm recognition of the personality of God, the supremacy of God, the holiness of God, the justice of God. You see the songs people sing in the world. Sometimes they sing to exalt an idol. Sometimes they sing to exalt man. Or sometimes they are singing about relationship between men and women, immorality. Or they are singing about some natural circumstances or history happening among them. But in this song, we see the exaltation of God, the recognition of the power of God, and the recognition and the appreciation for the holiness of God, as well as for the justice of God. This first song of scripture is praise to God, flowing out of joyful, grateful hearts. Israel's leaders, Moses and Miriam, participated in the singing unto the Lord. What an example, what a challenge for us, that all ministers and members in the church, in the Christian church, should participate in singing, rejoicing before the Lord whenever we sing. In fact, all the children of Israel, men and women, they sang the song of redemption unto the Lord. And the song contains sound doctrine, not false doctrine. We're very careful in this church that we do not allow songs from celestial or song from cherubim and seraphim and songs from the tradition. We do not allow those songs to come in, because those songs do not have sound doctrine concerning God. We're very, very selective in the songs that we sing. In fact, the gospel hymns and songs is a collection of carefully selected songs. And by the grace of God, that's another thing we're going to do. We're still going to expand that songbook. We're going to bring more carefully selected songs also in the future. But you see, the songs we sing should contain sound doctrine concerning God, concerning the plan of redemption. And this song we're looking at today also contains notes of consecration unto God. You'll find these people saying, "Is my God. It's my Father's God. I will exalt him." That's consecration. I will prepare him an habitation. It's like when we sing and we say, "I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all." We sing songs of consecration unto God. And the songs we sing should be patterned after the songs of scripture. As we come to this important chapter, a milestone in the lives of the children of Israel, an eye-opener for us who are children of the Lord and the redeemed of the Lord. We're going to look at the chapter. There is a lot in this chapter. We're going to divide into three parts. Number one, song of praise to Israel's holy and mighty God. God is holy, God is mighty. And we're looking at the song of praise unto that mighty and holy God. Number two, effect of Israel's mighty deliverance on their enemies. You see, the song they sang also revealed the effect of signs and wonders, the effect of miracles, the effect of deliverance, the effect of the mighty deliverance upon the enemies of the children of Israel. When we get to that part, there is a lot to learn there. There is a lot to learn there. Number three, test of Israel's faith and the healing covenant. There is a lot in each of these points. Let's now go to point number one. Song of praise to Israel's holy and mighty God. I'm reading to you from Exodus chapter 15. And I'm reading from verse 1. as I read on, I may make some explanations and applications as we go on from verse 1 to verse 13 and verses 20 and 21. Please pay attention as we look at the word. Then sang Moses and the children of Israel. They sung unto the Lord and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider has he thrown into the sea. You see the children of Israel here with the leadership. They began to sing unto the Lord. Do you know that there are some people, unfortunately, they count singing as a waste of time. In fact, there are some people, they do not come at the beginning of the Bible study, at the beginning of the revival hour, at the beginning of the worship. Well, they say, well, they will just be singing now. I will join them at the time of the reading and the study of Scripture. It's a wrong attitude. It's an unbiblical attitude. It's an unchristian attitude. You see, we ought to sing unto the Lord. In fact, we're encouraged in Scripture. Jesus himself sang in Scripture. That's in Matthew chapter 26. You see, Jesus Christ sang. The disciples sang. And when you go to the epistles, you go to Acts of the Apostles, Paul and Silas, those are apostles and leaders in the early church. They sang praises unto the Lord. You come to the epistles, the people of God also are commanded to sing. And so these children of Israel, they are not reached the end of the journey. They were still journeying on, but they stopped the journey now and they sang unto the Lord. Let us learn from that and let us make sure that we sing praises unto the Lord. In verse 2, what was the content of the singing of the song? What was the message, the wordings of the song? In verse 2, the Lord is my strength and song, and he's become my salvation, and he is my God. I will prepare him an habitation. My father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his hosts, as he cast into the sea, his chosen captains are also drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank into the bottom as a stone. Thy right hand, O Lord, is become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, has dashed in pieces the enemy. You see the children of Israel here, they were rejoicing because they serve a mighty God. Do you remember how we sing? What a mighty God we serve. And then we begin to recount the mighty things that he has done. Do you remember the songs that we sing? We say that I will sing unto the Lord. Do you remember the songs we sing? Praise him, praise him, praise him, a blessed Redeemer. Do you remember? Then sings my soul, how great thou art, how great thou art. You see, these children of Israel, they were commemorating, celebrating the might of the Lord, the power of the Lord. They said in verse 6, thy right hand, O Lord, is become glorious in power. They celebrated, they rejoiced in the power of the Lord. Thy right hand, O Lord, has dashed in pieces the enemy. You see, our mouth ought to sing the praise of the Lord. We ought to remember what the Lord has done, and we ought to glorify him. In verse 7, and in the greatness of thine excellency, thou hast overthrown them that rose up against thee. Thou sentest forth thy wrath, and which consumed them as stubble. I want you to understand here, they didn't exalt Moses in the singing. They referred everything to the Lord. They said, God did all this in the greatness of his excellency. Although God had told Moses to stretch out the rod, they didn't exalt the rod. It wasn't the method they exalted. And it wasn't Moses the man they exalted. They exalted the Lord. They said it was the greatness of the excellency of the Lord. In our singing, we do not sing unto the leader in the church, unto the leaders in the church as well. We do not do that. And we do not sing unto maybe the founder of this or the founder of that. That's what you find in some of these white garment churches. In their celebration, in their festivals, they begin to sing unto such and such, and then they begin to dance. And they will mention the names of so and so and the names of so and such and such. Isn't that what they do in the world? when they block out the street, when they are celebrating maybe or dedicating a house, and then they begin to mention this name, mention this name, mention this name. Whenever they are doing that near your house, you'll begin to hear the name of the man, the name of his wife, the names of the children, and the names of the cousin, and the name of their forefathers, and they begin to praise them. We don't do that in the Christian fold. We praise the name of the Lord alone. Notice here, no song was sung unto Moses. And no song was sung praising the Lord and praising the means of that the Lord used. Look at verse 8. And with the blast of thy nostrils, the waters were gathered together. The flood stood upright as an heap, and the depths were congealed in the heart of the sea. You see, the Lord had used the wind. If you read the whole of Exodus chapter 14, he had used the wind, and it blew against that river, and it stopped the Red Sea, and it was like a wall. And then the children of Israel, they made it very descriptive. You see, they are trying to describe the power of God. They said, do you see how we breathe? And the breath, the wind coming out, the air coming out of our nostrils will not even stop the movement of a mosquito. Then he's comparing the might of God, the greatness of God. And he says, when God breathes, the wind or the breath coming out of his nostrils will even make the Red Sea to stand up like a flood, like a wall of water. Look at it again in verse 8. With the blast of thy nostrils. You understand that now? The waters were gathered together. The flood stood upright like a wall, as an heap. And the depths were congealed in the heart of the sea. Verse 9. Then it says, the enemy said, I will pursue. I will overtake. I will divide the spoil. My lust shall be satisfied upon them. I will draw my sword. My hand shall destroy them. They looked at the enemies and they saw they were bragging. They saw how the enemies were thinking that they were going to finish the children of Israel without reckoning on the power of God. Now they came back to God. They said in verse 10, thou didst blow with thy wind. And then it says, the sea covered them. They sank as lead in the mighty waters. Then now, the sang part of the song we have been singing here, it says in verse 11, who is like unto thee, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like thee, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? Thou stretched out thy right hand. The earth swallowed them up. I want you to remember once again that when the sea was going to be divided, God told Moses to stretch out his hand. And Moses stretched out his hand with the rod. And the sea was divided. But they knew that it was representing the hand of God. So they were not going to celebrate the power of Moses. You see, that is what we say. And whenever God does a great things in our midst, we shouldn't give the glory to man. We shouldn't give the praise to man. They said, it is the right hand of the Lord that has done it. Then in verse 13, they said, thou in thy mercy hast led forth the people, which thou hast redeemed. Thou hast guided them in thy strength unto thy holy habitation. Let's go now to verse 20. It says in verse 20, and Miriam the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, took a timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out at her. Stop there for a moment. You see, do you learn something here? Moses was the leader over the children of Israel, and he led both the adults and the children, the men and the women. But then Miriam is referred to as a leader also, called a prophetess, but as a woman, the sister of Aaron. We're told that she took the timbrel in her hand. And then, who did she lead? Was she a leader over both the men and the women? No. Look at it. It says, and all the women went out after her. All the women. It is wonderful to have the scripture. You see, when we do things decently and in order, we will have a woman leader leading the women. And that is why you see in our choir some time ago, when we divided into districts, there were women that were leading the choir in their district. And although I appreciated their zeal, I appreciated their commitment, I appreciated their knowledge, I appreciated their willingness to sacrifice and to give of their service to the church and to the Lord. But then I said, we have to follow the Bible. Miriam, as a woman, the sister of Aaron, then she called all the women followed after her. Whenever it is a combination of men and women, you'll find generally in scripture, if men are available to do the leadership work, men are put over them to lead them. But when it is, women ministry, we have a woman and all the women will follow after, and that woman will have a great ministry. Some people grumble at that. Some people will say, why is it like that? Do you realize it was a great ministry? Because we're told that of the children of Israel, there were a little more than 600,000 men. And when you think of that, you think of also more than about 600,000 women. Because those men were men that most of them were married. And then you have other younger ones too that were ladies, that were girls, that had not married. You had more than 1 million of those women. Isn't that a great ministry? Why are we going to be grumbling that we're only put in charge of women? Those women are in their thousands. Look at our church here. Does anybody have any ground to complain? A woman leader would have hundreds of women to lead. And a woman leader might even have thousands of women to lead and to guide and to teach and to show the way of God and to show they in gratitude can follow after the Lord. Let's follow the scriptures. Let not our women fight over leadership or fight with the coordinators or fight with the leaders in the church. The women ministry that God has given you women, concentrate on that. And I thank the Lord when we made the change in the church and we said, well, you women that are leading the choir, we just want the men to take over. By the grace of God, the men took over according to the pattern of scripture. Now let's look at verse 21. And Miriam answered them, sing ye unto the Lord. Remember, she was talking, she was directing her commandment to the women. She was directing her leading of that song to the women and said, sing ye unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider are sea thrown into the sea. Have you read something similar to that before? Oh, yes. You see, the women do not have a separate doctrine. Exactly the doctrine that Moses had sung about in the songs while leading the whole of the children of Israel. Exactly that same doctrine you find Miriam repeating among the women. You know, it's unfortunate when in the women ministry a woman will come out with a strange doctrine, a new doctrine. And we'll say, they don't say this in the general church. They don't say this in a combined service. They don't say this among the men. But this is a new, strange doctrine I got from a dream. No, it is not like that. If you're a woman leader, the same doctrine we're emphasizing, the same doctrine that God has taught us in the church, as a woman leader, is the same doctrine you are going to continue with the people, with those women that God has granted you the opportunity of leading. Let's now consider the song itself. You see, I told you already that it was immediately after their deliverance that Israel sang the song unto the Lord. There is a close similarity, parallel, between this song and the song we find in the book of the Judges. Deborah and Barak sang praises to the Lord immediately after victory over Jabin, the king of Canaan. What a contrast is this. From what was before noted of the children of Israel in the earlier chapters. You see, in the earlier chapters, when the children of Israel were still in bondage, there was no joyful strain that we hear from the lips of those Hebrews. Instead, what did we read about them? They sighed by reason of their bondage. But now that deliverance had come, now that redemption had come, we're told that their sighing gave place to singing. Their groaning gave place to giving praise, giving glory unto God. They were no longer occupied with their suffering, with their sorrow, with their affliction. They were now occupied with the praise of the Lord. What had produced this startling change? Two things. Number one, the blood of the Lamb. Exodus
chapter 12. Number 2, the power of the Lord, Exodus chapter 14. It's a combination of what we have in Exodus 12, Exodus 14, that produced the song that they sang. By the blood, they had been washed. They had been protected. They had been redeemed. They had been purchased. They had become the people of God, the redeemed of the Lord. By the power of the Lord, they had been delivered from the enemy. They had been delivered from the Egyptians. And as a combination of those two things, now they could sing unto the Lord. It's the same thing in our lives. By the blood of the Lamb, we are forgiven. Our sins are washed away. We become the redeemed of the Lord. And we're no longer under the bondage, under the tyranny of sin. But not only that, by the power of the Lord, we are made more than conquerors. We overcome sin, we overcome the world, we overcome the flesh, we overcome demons, we overcome the devil, we overcome enemies of progress in our lives. And as a result of the combination of the manifestation of the blood of the Lamb and the power of the Lord, we now have a startling change, a wonderful change. And that makes us to sing unto the Lord. And what did Israel sing about? I've read the song unto you. Their song was entirely about God, not about man. Not about themselves. They not only sang unto the Lord, they sang about the Lord. In fact, I counted the word Lord in these verses that we have in this chapter. And as I counted, and you will see that the word Lord with capital letters appeared no less than 12 times within the first 21 verses. Not only that, the pronouns referring to the Lord, he, him, thou, thy, and thee, referring to God, appears not less than 33 times. In this song, do you see then how the song was glorifying God, was exalting God, was praising the Lord? How significant this is. How entirely different from modern church songs. In many of the modern church songs, you don't even hear the mention of the name of the Lord so often. But you see, the purpose of the song is revealed to us in verse 2. We've read that before. Let us look at it again. Verse 2, Exodus chapter 15, verse 2. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, I will prepare him an habitation, my father's God, and I will exalt him. The sum total of the purpose of the song is that they wanted to exalt the Lord. And you see that here, Israel's confidence was in God as my God. In fact, they refer to God as my strength, my song, my salvation. It is necessary to have personal faith, present faith in God when you sing unto the Lord. Singing, speaking to God, they refer to themselves as the people of the Lord, thy people, in verse 16. Such assurance brings joy when you know that the beloved is yours and you are his. When you realize that he is your redeemer and God has become your father, Jesus has become your savior, and you can use the personal pronoun, my God, my strength, my song, my salvation. Such assurance brings joy and strength and courage to people who are surrounded by enemies and strangers in a hostile and dangerous environment. Israel had known and learned that the elements were under the control of God. You see, in the land of Egypt, God used the dust, the ashes, the wind, the fire, the water, many things like that. They have known that all those things were under the control of God. Now they reminded themselves of that again. They talked about the wind as the blast from the nostril of the Lord. And that all those things will serve the purpose of the Lord and fulfill his will. Therefore, they sang about the greatness of his excellency. They observed and pictured the wind as a blast of his nostrils. And so they sang unto the Lord. And then I've already told you that they sang and they said, God is glorious in holiness and fearful in praises, that he is doing wonders. Now, let us move on to other references of Scripture as we realize that we too, as children of God, we are to sing unto the Lord. And I told you before that when we sing, we are following the example of the Lord Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ also sang. Now, we're looking at Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26. In this chapter from verse 26 to verse 29, Jesus had been with his own disciples, and he was telling them in verse 26, take, eat, this is my body. In verse 27, he said, drink ye all of it. In verse 28, he said, this is the blood of the New Testament. And then in verse 29, he says, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom. I read those verses to you for you to understand that is Jesus Christ talking here. Now look at verse 30. And when they had sung an hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. That's Jesus and his disciples sang. Jesus did not just close his mouth when the singing was going on. Do you know there are some church leaders today, they don't sing when the congregation is singing. And they feel that they are too big to sing. They are too great, they are too exalted to sing. They feel that their position as a leader among the people of God excuses them from singing. Jesus Christ sang. Moses sang. And Paul and Silas sang. And then we're told in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19, we're supposed to sing. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. When are we to sing? Are we to limit our singing to Monday, to Thursday, and to Sundays, to the house fellowship alone? No, look at Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. Philippians chapter 4, verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. You'll even remember Paul and Silas when they were in the dungeon, in the prison, in suffering and affliction. They sang unto the Lord. When you are sick, sing unto the Lord. When you are happy, sing unto the Lord. When you are hungry, sing unto the Lord. When you have eaten and you are full, sing unto the Lord. When you wake up in the morning, sing unto the Lord. In the bathroom, sing unto the Lord. In the living room, sing unto the Lord. On the way, sing unto the Lord. When there is difficulty confronting you, sing unto the Lord. And of course, when the Lord has done a mighty thing for you, has performed a miracle in your life, sing unto the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say unto you, rejoice. Let's now go back to Exodus chapter 15. Exodus chapter 15. We're now looking at the effect of Israel's mighty deliverance on their enemies. And as I told you in the introduction, this is very, very important. Very, very important. You see why I tell you it's very important. It's the effect of Israel's mighty deliverance on their enemies. In Exodus chapter 15, reading from verse 14, the people shall hear and be afraid. Sorrow shall take hold on the inhabitants of Palestina. You see here is something wonderful. The children of Israel in their singing, they said the inhabitants of Palestina, they will hear what God has done. They will hear what God has done. And they will be afraid. That is the effect of the testimony of the wonders of the Lord in the midst of the people of God. That is the effect it will have on them. The people shall hear and be afraid. Sorrow shall take hold on the inhabitants of Palestina. Look at verse 15. Then the dukes of Edom shall be amazed. The mighty men of Moab trembling shall take hold upon them. All the inhabitants of Canaan shall melt away. Do you know the importance of these verses I'm reading to you? The children of Israel had not gone this way before. The children of Israel were not great mighty warriors. The children of Israel did not know how they will fight against their enemies. And the dukes of Edom will be waiting for them. The people of Canaan will be waiting for them. And the Moabites will be waiting for them. The inhabitants of Palestina will be waiting for them. So that they will be able to stop them. Of course, remember how some of them stood by the way. And they said that the children of Israel will not pass by. And then the children of Israel said, one of our weapons is our testimony. You hear that? One of our weapons is our testimony. When we give our testimony, when we sing the song, when we make all this testimony, what God has done in dividing the Red Sea to spread all abroad, the people will hear, they will be afraid. They will not know that we don't have guns to shoot. They will not know we don't have arrows to shoot. They will not know that we do not have the physical weapons, but they will know that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They will know that the rod in the hand of Moses, the word of authority in the mouth of the leader, will do mighty things more than the gun, more than the spear. Because the inhabitants of Palestina, the dukes of Edom, and the inhabitants of Moab, and the inhabitants of Canaan, they will hear, they will be afraid, they will be amazed, they will tremble, and their hearts will melt away. Look at verse 16. Fear and dread shall fall upon them. You see, that is the importance of the testimony of the great and the mighty things that God himself is doing. It says, fear and dread shall fall upon them by thy greatness, by the greatness of thine arm. They shall be as steel as a stone till thy people pass over. O Lord, till thy people pass over, which thou hast purchased. Now, let me explain that verse to you. It says, fear and dread shall fall upon them. And it says, they shall be as steel as a stone until thy people pass over. Do you know that fear paralyzes people? Do you know that when people hear a kind of miracle, when they repeat it among themselves, that the mighty Red Sea, so deep that it will swallow a whole nation, if a whole nation got into it, they will say, do you know what happened? The mighty Red Sea opened up, and the children of Israel passed over. And when the children of Israel passed over, the river could not cover them. And they just went over. The Egyptians, with all their science, with all their magic, with all their sorcery, with all their evil power, with all their mighty power, with all the things they had, with all the witchcraft, that those people entered into that thing, the rod of Moses made the waters to cover them and to sweep them all away. The people will be paralyzed with fear. They will not be able to move. When the children of Israel will be passing, they'll be as steel as stone, not able to raise any hand. That will be the effect of the testimony upon them. That will be the effect of the telling of the story, of the testimony, of recounting what the Lord has done before those individuals and before those nations. Now listen to this. Those children of Israel, what if they spoke about their disagreement with Moses? And all that they will hear in Canaan is that those children of Israel, their disagreement with Moses, they are murmuring against Moses. They are complaining against Moses. That will not make them to be still as stone. That will not make them to be afraid. That will not make them to tremble. That will not make their hearts to melt. What if they will say, well, we're not satisfied with the food God is giving us, the manna that is coming from heaven. What if that is what the people were hearing? That those people, there's no unity among them. There's no harmony among them. That in fact, all the food God is giving them, they are not satisfied at all. They are grumbling. They are murmuring. In fact, they want to stone their leader. You see, all that will not bring any fear in the hearts of the people. Now let me draw the lesson I'm driving at. This important, pay attention. You see, in those days, that's why I told you that in few tough days, after this time, by the grace of God, we're going to bring some of these things back in the central Thursday revival time. And once again, the people of the world are going to be afraid when they hear of the mighty, mighty things that the Lord will be doing. You see, in the past, when we came together and the Lord did those mighty things among us, did you know that the herbalists were fearing us? They said, deep alive, don't touch them. Do you know that when some of our boys and girls were kidnapped, and they were taken to a forest or to a bush, while they were trying to scrape their ear, do you know what happened? The fire surrounded them, and the people were afraid. They said, why did you bring this deeper life person here? Let me read to you once again in verse 16. In verse 16, fear and dread shall fall upon them. And that was the effect when all those miracles were happening. And that time, we were not talking about, the problems we had. We are not talking about, I disagree with coordinator. If that is what you are telling your neighbor does not come to church, your neighbor doesn't know the Lord, your neighbor is not a member of the church, all that you are discussing is that, well, my coordinator doesn't like me. In fact, I don't like him too. His wife, when I greet him, his wife will not greet me. And I've made up my mind, I will not greet his wife also. That's what you are telling the Muslim. That's what you are telling the churchgoer. That's what you are telling the people. Oh, the people will not be afraid of you. You are telling your old friends in Celestia that I want you to go come back. That I want you to do some chants and some things against you so that you'll be mental, so that you'll come back. You are telling them, do you know, since I left SLA and I came to Deeper Life, I thought I will see the pastor, but now I've not been able to see. SLA will say, eh? You have not been able to see the pastor. I catch you. If you are not able to see the pastor, then you are in my hand. Then all that I wanted to do, I was fearing you before. I cannot. So you cannot even see your pastor. They cannot pray for you. I've been going there every Wednesday. I never see. Okay, if you cannot see him, now I catch you. You are the people that make them to be able to catch you and to be able to oppress you. But if you say, I praise the Lord. All the testimonies that we have been hearing in Deeper Life, you tell your neighbors, you tell the people who are going to other churches, you tell those who are cooking in the kitchen with, you tell those who are using the same house with you, those who are bragging, those who may threaten you. When you tell them those testimonies, mighty testimonies, great testimonies, number one, it will bring up more grace and more faith in your own heart. Number two, it will strike faith and fear and trembling in the hearts of the people. But if you are just saying, well, I'm in disagreement with our coordinator. I'm in disagreement with the wife of the coordinator. In fact, in our church now, I don't really understand them. They are hindering me from seeing the pastor. If that is what you are telling them, they will catch you. They will catch you. They will do something against you. But if you tell them that, even if I don't see pastor, if I see pastor passing like this, and I wave my hand at him and he waves at me, finish. No witch can catch me. That the power of God is so great in our church that even if it is in a dream, I see pastor like this and he prays for me, finish. But if you tell a negative thing, it will be terrible. But in the case of the children of Israel, they said, our God is mighty. The unbelievers will hear, they will be afraid. Let me show you the fulfillment of what they said in Joshua chapter 2. Joshua chapter 2, reading from verse 9. And she said unto the men, I know that the Lord has given you the land, and that your terror is falling upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land fear because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you. We have heard. Everyone in the land of Canaan, we have heard. The young has heard, the old has heard, the men have heard, the women have heard. The mighty ones have heard. The magicians have heard. The sorcerers have heard. The witches have heard. The people that were sacrificing their children unto fire, they have all heard. Every one of them, when they heard, there was no more strength in them again. They were afraid. Look at verse 11. And as soon as we had heard these things, our heart did melt. Neither was there any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and in the earth beneath. I want to tell you something. The testimony, the miracle, the sign and the wonder that Rahab was referring to here was already 40 years old. 40 years before it had happened. Just when they were coming out of the land of Egypt. Don't you see that is what he said? She said in verse 10, for we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when ye came out of Egypt. At this time that she was talking, Moses had died. 40 years had gone. And yet she was still talking about the testimony, and she was still saying, the impact of that miracle is still upon us now. The impact of that miracle is still making us to tremble. It's still making us to fear. That means that all the miracles that we have had in this church, oh, they are not stale. They're still new. You will talk about them. You will repeat them. And when you talk about them, what you discover is that there will be fear in the hearts of the unbelievers. There will be trembling. And then they will know that our God is a great God. Let's look at Psalm 48. Psalm 48, reading from verse 3. The effect of the miracles and the effect of the testimonies when we tell them, God is known in our palaces for a refuge. For lo, the kings were assembled. They passed by together. They saw it. And so they marveled. They trembled and hasted away. Fear took hold upon them there, and pain as of a woman in travail. Thou breakest the sheaves of Tarshish with an east wind, as we have heard. So have we seen in the city of the Lord of hosts, in the city of our God. God will establish it forever. We have thought of thy loving kindness, O God, in the midst of thy temple, according to thy name, O God. So is thy praise unto the ends of the earth. Thy right hand is full of righteousness. You see there, when you mention all the great things, the mighty things the Lord himself has done, you'll find that it will increase your faith. It will increase the fear of the people of the world. If you want the world to fear you, talk of the testimonies of what the Lord is doing. Don't talk about your problems to them. Don't talk about your unbelief unto them. Don't talk about your doubts unto them. Never open your mouth. You see, you are a woman and your husband is not a believer. Don't talk about your doubts. Don't talk about church problem. Don't talk about the disagreement you have with so and so in the church. Talk about the miracles. Talk about the signs. Talk about the power of God. If you want your husband to be saved, you're not going to be talking about church problem to him. Talk about the power of God. If you're a man and you happen to be a child of God, your wife is not born again yet, don't talk about church problem. Talk about the miracles, about the power of God. And it is what will make your wife to tremble before the Lord. It is what will even bring conviction upon her. Not only that, if you want your relatives to be healed when they are sick, you want them to be delivered when they are oppressed, when you bring them to the church, you want them to believe when we pray, then talk about the miracles to those your relatives. Don't talk about the problems you have with the pastor, with the leader, with the coordinator, with the women rep, with anybody. Talk about the power of God. Not only that, do you know your children need the power of God. If you want your children to be able to believe when we pray, to be able to fear the name of the Lord, to respect the name of the Lord, talk about the miracles to your children. Don't talk about the zonal leader so and so that you don't agree with, about the coordinator that you don't agree with, about so and so that you have a difficulty, a disagreement with. If you talk about those things, you're not helping your children. If you want your children to believe when we pray, to believe when we counsel, and to believe when we try to help them, you talk about the power of God. And well, you say, but what testimony will I talk about? After all, we have not been having that combined revival service. Can't you talk about the testimony of 2 years ago, 3 years ago, 4 years ago? Because in the case of the children of Israel, Rahab said, we heard of what happened 40 years ago. We're still trembling. We're still shaking. We still know that your God is a great God. Even though the testimonies we heard about is the dividing of the Red Sea that took place 40 years ago. Those many things that took place some years ago, repeat them. Reassure yourself that our God is able, is still able to do them. In fact, they went beyond just the fear of the Canaanites and the Moabites and the people of Palestine. And look at the climax of what the miracle did for them in verse 18. Exodus chapter 15 and verse 18. The Lord shall reign forever and ever. That was a conclusion in their heart. They knew that the Lord will reign forever and ever. Let's now go to the third point, the test of Israel's faith and the healing covenant. The test of Israel's faith and the healing covenant. In Exodus chapter 15, we're reading from verse 22.
So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur. And they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. That is, there was no water to drink. Now I want you to see something here. They had been rejoicing before the Lord, singing before the Lord, celebrating the name of the Lord. They came out of the drowning waters of the Red Sea, and now they found no drinking water for 3 days. This was caused by the devil, and God permitted it for a purpose. On the side of the devil, he wanted to cut short their joy. On the side of the devil, he wanted to create a problem for them. On the side of the devil, he wanted to say, what are you singing about? What are you rejoicing about? Isn't that what happens in life? That many times, something wonderful has happened. And immediately that thing has happened, then there is a problem. Take for example, you are born again, you are saved. And there is the joy of salvation. While you are singing, persecution comes. The devil wanting to cut off that problem, that praise of the Lord. Not only that, you attend a retreat, or it's at the Bible study, or the Sunday worship, or any time, you pray and you are sanctified. And immediately after you are sanctified, you are singing unto the Lord, rejoicing before the Lord. And eventually there is a problem that comes up. It may be that, somebody becomes sick, and what the devil wants to do is to cut the joy off right there. Or it is something the Lord has done for you, you just passed your exam. And it's a wonderful result. And while you are rejoicing, you look for a job and there's no job yet. You see, the devil will bring a problem after you have started praising the name of the Lord. Or it is that here you are, you have witnessed and somebody has come to the Lord. And you are so joyful because that message has brought a soul to know the Lord. But then you get to the house, and while you are rejoicing, the landlord has a difficulty, has a problem with you. He's saying it's going to increase the house rent. The devil wants to cut off the joy. You find that many times when God has done something for you and there's a praise of God in your mouth, a problem may come. But realize that problem is a trial of faith. For the multitudes of the children of Israel, while they were singing before the Lord, they now came to this place and there was no water to drink. And in the next verse, after they had gone 3 days without water, they saw water but they could not drink that water. Verse 23, and when they came to Marah, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore the name of it was called Marah. You see here again, they saw water. I want you to picture the people that were on a journey. And 3 days there had been no water to drink. And they were eager to find water to drink. Now they saw water. But then when they tasted, it was bitter, undrinkable. Now in verse 24, here is the result. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? They stopped singing, they started murmuring. Do you know what this shows? It shows that it's not enough to be purchased, we must be purged. It's not enough to be praising, we must be purified. It shows it's not enough to be redeemed and saved, we must be sanctified. These people thought all problems were over. They thought, look at the way we are singing. They thought, we don't need any spiritual experience anymore, we've got it all. Then when there was no water, they saw that although they were redeemed, although they were saved, although they were purchased by the blood of the Lamb, although they had got the victory by the Red Sea, they needed to be saved within them. They needed to be sanctified. The corruption was still there. Something that will grumble and complain was still there. And they needed God to take that away from them. It is part of God's wisdom that sometimes He will allow a circumstance to come in our lives that will show us the need of sanctification. Those trials and testings in the wilderness made manifest the evil in their heart, the corruption in their flesh so often. Circumstances that God may permit in our lives will reveal that there remains an inward corruption that needs to be taken away, that needs to be purged, even after we had been saved. They murmured against Moses, and they said, what shall we drink? Isn't that very solemn? 3 days before, these people were singing. Now they murmured. Now I want to bring in something here. We who are leaders in the church, we who are preachers in the church, you see, it's very difficult to rely upon the appreciation of the people. You know, you leaders will understand this. You'll be surprised that here we are today, this week, somebody will say, oh, I praise the name of the Lord for brother so-and-so, our zonal leader. I praise the name of the Lord for our coordinator. I praise the name of the Lord for such and such. And you coordinator, you zonal leader, you are rejoicing, you are happy. My people appreciate me, and they want me to be coordinator over them forever and ever till Jesus will come. You'll be surprised while you are thinking that everybody appreciates you. You'll be surprised 1 week after they are murmuring, what has he ever done? What has he ever done for us? Does he visit us? Does he look at us when we suffer? Does he see this or does he see that? All this we study in the Bible, they show us that we should not rely on the appreciation of the members. When they come, that's all right. When the appreciation is there, that's all right. But we should not rely on the appreciation of anyone. Your reward is going to come from God. Otherwise, you will be disappointed when after 1 week, they begin to murmur. They begin to complain. You know, sometimes as a pastor, I realize that, you know, sometimes you will find there's some members. And they'll say, oh, pastor, we praise the Lord. They will say, it was because of me that this Deeper Life Bible Church was established. They will say, if it were not for Deeper Life, where will I be now? They praise God, they rejoice before God, they sing, and then they will say, I will never leave this church. And then as a pastor, if I didn't know the Bible, I'll say, praise the Lord, we have arrived. Praise the Lord. See how the people appreciate the church. And then after 1 week, they will say, which pastor is that? Do we ever see him? Is he at all? We don't know whether he has gone to Japan now. We don't know whether he has gone to another place. He's here, he's there. And we don't know whether he has gone to the east or gone to the north. Do we ever see him at all? Which Wednesday did I see him now? I have tried 2-3 times. In fact, I don't know whether I want to stay in the church again. You know, people, that's how people are. But you know, we just depend upon the Lord in leadership. That the Lord appreciates. You know, the Lord doesn't change like that. The Lord appreciates your work as a leader, coordinator. The Lord appreciates your work as a leader, women coordinator, zonal leader, women representative, area leader, house fellowship leader, a member of the choir, usher, or electronics person. The Lord appreciates your work. You know, sometimes, you know, we come out of the Bible study and the cassette was marvelously wonderful. And we say, you know, we should be praying for those electronics people, how they record this for us, and we thank God for them. Were it not for cases in this, our church, where will we be now? How will we enjoy all these wonderful Bible studies? And then one day, a little mistake, maybe the cassette is stiff, and then the thing is not working at all. The people say, this is what we are saying. These electronics, they don't know their work, they don't know this. Electronics people don't depend upon the praise of people. If they praise you, just say, thank God, give glory to God, because you don't know what they are going to say after 3 days. You see, in this case, they were singing. And while they were singing, then there was no water. And the 3 days after that, they began to murmur, they began to complain. Praising gave place to murmuring. God brought Israel to the place of testing, and sadly, they failed. Their murmuring was not against Moses really. In reality, their murmuring was against the Lord. And so it is with us today. Do you know, every complaint for in our circumstances about our daily trials of life, they are actually a complaint against the Lord, who worketh all things after his own counsel, after the counsel of his own will. What was the cause of their murmuring? There's only one thing we can give as an answer. Their eyes were no longer upon the Lord. They did not even attempt to pray. They murmured, they never prayed. But thank God for the Moses who could pray. And this is a lesson we learn from leadership. That when the congregation murmurs, the leadership should pray. When there is difficulty, the leadership should pray. When they do not appreciate your efforts and your service, you should pray. Moses prayed. He cried unto the Lord. What did the Lord do? Let us look at it in verse 25. And he cried unto the Lord, And the Lord showed him a tree, which when he had cast into the waters were made sweet. And there he made for them a statute and an ordinance, and there he proved them. You see that? And the fact that there was no water, God knew about it. It was to test them. It was to prove them. Many things that God would allow in our lives are just to prove us and to test us to see whether we will continue with the Lord. The tree had been there before, but Moses did not see. It was when he prayed, the Lord opened his eyes and he saw. That tree points us to the cross of Jesus Christ, who his own self bear our sins in his own body on the tree. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 24. The cross of Jesus Christ is that which makes whatever may be bitter in our lives to become sweet unto us. It was after that he gave them now the healing covenant. Before we close, let's look at the healing covenant he made with them. In verse 26, and said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and will give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of those diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee. Here is the healing covenant. The Lord promised the children of Israel. He said, learn your lesson. Change from murmuring to trusting. Change from complaining to believing the Lord. He said, from now on, if you will manifest faith and keep the fellowship and be obedient to my commandments, I will not bring the diseases of Egypt upon you. But I am the Lord that healeth thee. Let us learn our lesson from there. Let us stop grumbling, stop complaining, stop murmuring. Your faith will not increase while you are grumbling. While you are murmuring, the sickness will not go because you are murmuring. Water will not come on the basis of your murmuring. And the provision will not come on the basis of murmuring and quarreling and fighting and complaining. Let us learn a lesson. Let us be sanctified. So that in whatever condition we find ourselves, while we are waiting for the answer to our prayer, we'll be praising the name of the Lord. We'll be trusting in the Lord. Our trust and confidence will be in the Lord. We'll have faith in God, fellowship with God and his people. Not only that, we will be obedient to the commandments of the Lord. The benefit of healing, the benefit of provision, the benefit of answered prayer, the benefit of deliverance will only continue in our lives when we continue to trust in the Lord. In Exodus chapter 23. Verse 25, and ye shall serve the Lord your God. There is a condition. Ye shall serve the Lord your God, and he shall bless thy bread and thy water, and I will take sickness away from the midst of thee. You see the condition there. You serve the Lord your God. If you fulfill that condition, then he will bless your bread and bless your water, and he will take sickness away from the midst of you. In Deuteronomy chapter 7, Deuteronomy chapter 7 verse 15. And the Lord will take away from thee all sickness, everything, all sickness, and will put none of the evil diseases of Egypt which thou knowest upon thee, but will lay them upon all them that hate thee. The condition is again, if you are going to listen to the word of God in verse 12, wherefore it shall come to pass, if ye hearken to these judgments, and keep and do them, that the Lord thy God shall keep unto thee the covenant and the mercy, which he sware unto thy fathers. If we have been complaining, we need to repent of all that grumbling. Why did you allow the devil to stop your joy, to stop your singing, to stop your praising the Lord? Were we not the people that praised the Lord, that clapped our hands, that sang unto the Lord when those mighty miracles were happening? Why are you not singing that same song? Why are you not praising God that same way? Why are you not looking up to the hills, up to heaven, where your help comes from? Why are you not rejoicing before the Lord? Why couldn't you sing like Paul and Silas in the prison when their difficulty rose to the highest point? And they sang unto the Lord. And then the Lord came down in a mighty force and mighty power. And then all the foundations of the prison were shaking. And then we're told that all the bands were loose and the doors were open. Even if you're sick today, even if you're still oppressed today, even if you have a need today, even if there had not been water to drink, even if there had been trouble, even if there has been trial and test of faith, even if it appears that you don't have enough money, even if it appears difficulties and problems are there, why don't you, like Paul and Silas, why don't you sing unto the Lord? And in the midst of that singing, in the midst of that rejoicing, in the midst of that glorifying of the Lord, that the Lord will perform a great miracle in your life. Do you remember what I'm telling you? Because it says, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto the Lord. They were in the prison. They had been beaten. In fact, their backs were bleeding. And he said they sang praises unto God. And the prisoners had them. And suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaking. And immediately, all the doors were open and everyone's bands were loose. If you want the bands to be loosed, if you want the doors of your prison to be open, if you want your need to be met, if you want God to be glorified in your life, start singing rather than murmuring. And start praising the Lord rather than complaining. Let us rise up upon our feet. Remember what the Lord has done for you. Count your blessings and name them one by one. Name them one by one and praise the name of the Lord. And make up your mind that you will now, from now on, you'll not talk about problem, talk about God's power. You'll not talk about your trial, give your testimony. You'll not talk about your disagreements, talk about the great things, the deeds of the Lord, the things that the Lord has done. It will bring fear to the inhabitants of Palestina, to the Moabites, and to the dukes of Edom. It will bring fear upon them, the people of Canaan, when they hear the testimony, the great things the Lord has done and the Lord is doing. They will tremble. The witches will be afraid of you. The sorcerers will be afraid of you. If you do not complain, if you do not murmur, if you are not talking in your house, in the street, in the office, about your disagreement with any member of the church, you're only talking about testimony. Make up your mind. I'll never talk about negative things. Anything I tell those people outside the church, it will be the testimony of the great things of the Lord. The testimony of the great things the Lord has done for us in this church. That will increase your faith. That will bring fear upon them. It will make your victory to come speedily unto you from the Lord. Arise and pray and praise the name of the Lord.